Hello friends, welcome back to this video. In this video, we'll be talking about the Gram-Smith orthogonalization process. So as the name suggests, it's the process in which we orthogonalize our signals. So if you remember, if I have the finite dimension space, in that finite dimension space, I have some basis functions. I hope you all have seen my previous video and I hope you recall what is a basis function. So if I have m dimension space, I'll be having m number of basis function. Like if I have 3 dimension space, I have I, j and k. So now what is the property of the basis function? The multiplication of 2 different basis function from 2 different dimensions would be 0. And if I multiply the basis function in the same direction, I'll be getting 1. So phi I t multiplied with phi j t is equal to 0, and phi I t multiplied with phi I t, it is equal to 1. So this is the reason why I am representing my signal in the form of basis function. Now I have different signals which are not orthogonal, neither they are orthonormal to each other. Now I am converting these signals into the form of basis function so that they'll be exhibiting these properties which are very important, so that I can extract my signal without the interference of the other dimension signal. So we'll be studying the Gram-Smith orthogonalization process to understand that how I can convert a non-orthogonal and non-orthonormal signal into an orthonormal basis function. So let's suppose I have some signals. I have some signal S1T, S2T up to SMT. So I have M dimension and I have taken M signals. So now here, these are my signals. So now here, if I am considering G1T, G2T up to GMT. So these are my orthogonal signals or orthogonal function. So signal would neither be orthogonal, neither it is normalized. So it is not orthonormal. So now here, these are orthogonal and we can easily convert the orthogonal signal into orthonormal signal. So let's suppose I have phi 1t, phi 2t up to phi mt. These represents my basis function. And now it is orthonormal. I hope you remember how I can find out the orthonormal function. So now if I need to find out the orthonormal function for G1T, so if I have G1T, so orthonormal function, phi 1 is the orthonormal function of the G1T, and phi 1 is given by G1T upon norm of G1T. So this is the condition for the orthonormality of a function. So here I can divide the function by its norm, I'll get the orthonormal function. So this is the procedure by which I can convert an orthogonal signal to orthonormal signal. So I hope now up to this point everything is clear to you. So now we'll be looking into various dimensions and we'll be seeing how I can convert the signals which are not orthonormal into the orthonormal basis function. So I have some signals which are neither orthogonal nor orthonormal. I need to convert these signals into the orthonormal form. So let's see how we'll be doing that. So if I have one dimension, so I have just one signal S1T. So S1T represents the one dimensional signal. So the signal is like this. So this is my S1T and this is on this line. So if I need to find out G1T the orthogonal signal for the S1T. So what would be the signal? So this signal will lie on S1T only. So here I'll be taking the G1T equal to the S1T, because if I have some point, it is normal to it. So now here this point is normal to this line. I hope you can see that. So now I have directly chosen S1T is equal to G1T. So now here my G1T is spanning on this line. So here this axis only is represented by the G1T. So now if I need to find out the phi1T. So as I already told you, phi1T is the normalized function G1T. So here I'll be dividing G1T by under root of energy of G1T. Or I can say, I can divide G1T with the norm of G1T. So this represents my phi1T, and phi1T is the one dimensional basis function. So it is, I can write it as 1D basis function. So now if I have simply one signal in one direction, I can easily find out the basis function for this signal. It is really easy. Now the problem arises from the two dimensions. So when I have two dimension signal, so now here if I have two signals, so let's suppose I have this to be my first signal. This is my first signal and this is my second signal. So, or this is my second signal, this is my first signal. I have chosen this to be my S2 and this to be my S1. Now, it is clearly visible. S2 and S1 are not orthogonal. They are not making 90 degree angle. So let's suppose I have a signal which is making the 90 degree angle with the axis of S1T. So now this is my G2T, and now here I'll be taking phi1T to be a unit vector on S1T only. So this blue line represents the phi1T. So S1T is equal to G1T, and this represents my phi1T. So now here if I need to find out this distance, so if I need to find out this distance, I can easily find out this distance in the terms of phi1T, because phi1T is a unit vector in this direction, and if I multiply it with some constant, I'll be getting this distance. So let's suppose this distance is x. So x can be equal to c of phi1T. So now I hope this thing is really clear, because phi1T is a unit vector. Its magnitude is 1 and its direction is in the direction of this line. I need to find out the length x. So length x could be any variable c multiplied by phi1t. So now here I need to find out g2t. I have already chosen my g1t to be equal to s1t. So first axis I have taken to be my G1T. Now the perpendicular axis is G2T. I need to find out this G2T. So G2T I need to find out. So what I'll be doing, I'll be using this triangular and I'll be finding out the vector equation. So S2T is the summation of the vector x plus G2T. So now if I need to find out G2T, it is S2T minus x. So what was x? X was S2T minus x is c of phi1T. So now what is this c? I need to find out this c. C is actually the projection of S2 on S1. So now here if I provide a light source, so this is my light and the light is having some the light is actually vertical. So this is my light source. So the light rays will provide a shadow at this axis g1t. So the shadow is having some length. This length is called the projection. So here with the help of light, I'll be finding out the projection, and the projection of s2t on phi 1 axis. I have already told you about the projection in my previous video. So the projection of s2t on phi 1 axis is s21. So c is my projection of s2 on phi 1t. So c is equal to s21t. So it would be s2t minus, instead of c I'll be putting s21t into phi 1t. So now this is the formula. I can find out g2t. So now if I need to find out phi 2t, g2t is the orthogonal function, phi 2t is the orthonormal function. So s2t minus s21t phi 1t, it is divided by under root of e2 minus s21 square. So its value magnitude is under root e2 minus s21 square. I'll divide the g2's magnitude by the value of g2, which was s2t minus s21t phi 1t. So I'll get the orthonormal. This was g2t was the orthogonal function. So phi 2t, when it is divided by its magnitude, now its magnitude has converted into 1. So it is orthonormal function. So now I hope it is clear that how in two dimension I can easily find out the orthonormal function. So now we'll be talking about the s21t. So s21t can be find out using the formula of perpendicularity condition. So I can say g2 is perpendicular on s1. You can see directly that g2 is perpendicular on phi 1 or g1. So g2 will be perpendicular on s1 as well. So now when g2 is perpendicular on s1, then their dot product will be 0. So I have represented it in the form of inner products. So now g2 comma s1 is equal to 0. So I'll be putting the value of g2. g2 was s2t minus c of phi 1t. Instead of t I am just writing s2 and c phi 1. So now instead of phi 1 I can represent, so phi 1 was equal to g1 and g1 was equal to s1. So now instead of phi 1 I'll be replacing it with s1, and here I had s1. So now with the help of this I'll be finding out what is my mathematical value of s21. So now here this is the inner product, and here I can write the inner product as s2 inner product with s1, and this is minus, so c is a constant, and s1's inner product with s1, it is 0. So now here s2's inner product with s1 minus c, the inner product of s1 with s1 is the norm of s1 square is equal to 0. So now if I need to find out c will be equal to s2's inner product with s1 upon norm of s1 square. So if I put it in the form of signal, so s1t is inner product with s2t, or it was s2t inner product with s1t upon norm of s1t square. So now this is how I can find out c or s21t. So now I hope it is clear how I can find out this s21t. So now I need to verify that this G2 which I have found out is perpendicular to G1 or not. So this equation should be perpendicular to my G1. So now if I have G2 and G1 following the perpendicular condition. So when the perpendicular condition is followed, the inner product of G2 with G1 is equal to 0. So let's verify it. So it is equal to 0 or not. So now when I put the value of G2, the value of G2 was S2 minus. So what is C? C I have found out. C was S2 comma S1 upon mod of norm of S1 square. So now this was C and it is multiplied with 5 and T. So instead of that I am taking again S1. So now this is V1 and G1 was equal to S1. So this should be equal to 0. So now here if I have taken this to be equal to 0, I'll simplify it and verify that RHS is equal to LHS or not. If RHS is equal to LHS, which means the perpendicularity condition is satisfied, which means G2 and G1 are perpendicular. So that I have found out this G2, it is actually perpendicular to G1 and I have found out the best possible results. So now S2, I have already found out the inner product. I have already told you how I can find out. So S2's inner product with S1 minus S2 S1 upon S1 square S1's inner product with S1. So now here I know S1's inner product with S1 is norm of S1 square. So this will be cancelled with this and this minus this is equal to 0. So I can say LHS is equal to RHS, which means G1 is perpendicular to G2. So now one thing is clear, that G1 and G2 are perpendicular to each other, and how I can find out the value of S21 or C. So now I hope this equation is really clear to you. So now coming to the three dimensions. So I hope now you have realized this thing, that if G2 will become 0, if suppose this G2 is 0, then S2T will lie on S1T only. So this axis will come here and lie on this axis only. But the, according to the property of the bases, so the inherent property of the bases is that the two basis functions should be linearly independent. If I have S1T and S2T both lying on the same axis, I can find out S2T in the terms of S1T easily. So if I have S1T on this axis and S2T here, like here on this axis only, so I can easily find out S2T in the terms of S1T. But this is against the basic properties of the bases. These are linearly independent. So this G2T can never be equal to 0. So this is also the property of the bases. So the basis function G2T will never be equal to 0. Now coming to the three dimension. So in the three dimension, so here this was my G2T, here again I have taken G1T is equal to S1T. Now here G3T will be equal to, G2T is like this only, and G3T is equal to S3T minus S31T 5 1T minus S32T 5 2T. So now I hope it is clear. If I need to find out G3, I'll subtract S31T 5 1T from S3T as well as S32T 5 2T from S3T. So I'll be getting G3T. So this is the just extension of my G2T. Now if I need to find out the generalized equation for ith dimension, now I hope you know this is orthogonal function. This is not orthonormal. This is orthogonal. Now if I divide this G3 by its magnitude, then I'll get the phi 3. Then I'll get the basis. Till then, it is just the orthogonal function. So now in I dimension, GIT will be equal to SIT minus summation J is equal to 1 to I minus 1 SIJT minus SIJT multiplied by phi JT. So this is the condition to find out the ith dimension G function. So phi IT will be equal to GIT divided by under root of energy of GIT. So now I hope it is clear. I hope you can easily find out now nth dimension phi function. So what we have done? We have taken the signals which were not perpendicular to each other, which were not orthogonal. So now first we made them orthogonal and after that we made them orthonormal. Orthogonal to orthonormal is really easy. We can just divide it by its norm and easily orthogonal will come into the orthonormal form. So if I have g1t, I can divide g1t by its norm and I can easily find out phi1t. So one dimension was really easy. One dimension we just took g1t is equal to s1t. But in two dimension, we took g2t which was not equal to 0 and we found out the g2t. So similarly, I can find out phi2t, and this is how I proved that what is my s21t or the projection of s2 on s1. So this is how I can easily find out s21, and now I have generalized it to 3 dimension and ith dimension also. So here I'll be concluding my session. I hope you understood each and everything. If you still have any doubt, you can put the doubt in the comment and I'll try to resolve it as soon as possible. I hope you like this video. If you like it, share it with your friends, subscribe the channel and push the like button. Thank you.